sick. Peace could last forever. And in my first memories, they shot Kennedy. I went numb when I learned to see. So I never fell for being there. We got the wall of deceit to remind us all that you can't trust freedom when it's not in your hands. When everybody's fighting for their promised land.
Mingling with the rush hour traffic, Red Army armored personnel carriers on the streets of Moscow this morning, heading to the Kremlin. They first moved in at 4 a.m., the first sign of the coup d'etat that removed Mikhail Gorbachev from power. With tanks in Red Square, the official word from the new government, calling itself the National Emergency Committee.
Dan, can you tell us what has just happened?
Yes, Peter. Four blocks north of the World Trade Center, the second building that was hit by the plane has just completely collapsed. The entire building has just collapsed, as if a demolition team set off. When you see the old demolitions of these old buildings, it folded down on itself and it is not there anymore. It
Thanks
has
very
completely
much,
collapsed.
Hi, this is Vincent Von Doom with Disaster Survival Magazine's weekly radio broadcast. I am very excited to have with us, I've had a really hard time getting him on, his book is in very high demand, Ricahrd Stephenson, author of the New American series. Rich, are you with us?
Yes, I am. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
I'm very excited to have you on. I've been trying to get you on for the past week or two, but, you know, with everything going on, it's been hard to get you on. Your book, the New America series, the first book, Collapse, and the second one, Resistance. I love the covers, by the way.
Thank you.
Very intriguing.
I wish I could say I did them myself, but I'm a horrible artist. You remember that app on the phone, Draw Something, you know, where you play with your friends? I was so
yes.
terrible at it. I had to delete the app. I was so horrible at it. So I had a very talented graphic artist design the cover for me, you know, with my input and all that. And I've been extremely pleased with the work that I got.
Yes, it's very, very intriguing cover. So Collapse, a lot of rumors on the internet are starting to throw out that word that, you know, with all the banker deaths, that it could be America's turn real soon, that if Russia, China, and the rest of the world decide to throw away the dollar as the reserve currency, that we could be looking at a collapse. What do you think about what's going on in the news lately?
Well, I think that it's arrogant and very prideful of the American people to think that we're impervious to our nation collapsing around us. It's not something that you really see out there, and I think that's what makes my trilogy very unique is that. You know, you don't see a lot of end-of-the-world scenarios where we are the cause of our own downfall. It's usually from some sort of outside force, an invading country or, you know, an asteroid hits or, you know, a killer plague wipes everybody out. And don't get me wrong, I absolutely, you know, love that type of genre, but it's actually kind of funny how I arrived at writing this novel was my favorite genre book to read has always been, you know, apocalypse and dystopian novels. And I was always on the lookout for a book that, you know, kind of fit that description that, you know, wasn't really, you know, some huge outside force or, you know, one, you know, supernatural thing like, you know, zombies or, you know, a killer asteroid wiping us out or some killer plague. And I always wanted to see a book that – I always wanted to read a book that was plausible, something that was believable that could actually happen, you know. And I never could find that book. And what disturbed me was I thought I had found the perfect novel. I had heard some chatter about it, and I was like, hey, this novel looks really good. And, you know, reading the description of it, you know, it was exactly the type of book that I thought that would, you know, really satisfy me. Well, me being the very dedicated reader that I am, if I start a book, I finish it. Unless, you know, the first, you know, couple of pages are just horrible. I would give it the benefit of the doubt, figure, you know, if I, you know, have invested my own research into this book and it looks like something I'm going to read, I'm going to finish it. Well, this book that I read was so god-awful. I probably finished 25% of it, and I couldn't believe how terrible it was. And I thought, you know what? I think I could probably write a better book than this. And I guess that's where my motivation came from, was doing that myself. But yeah, like we were saying, I think that it's arrogant for us to think that, you know, we're impervious to it. And we do have a, you know, a very great nation that, you know, that I carry pride in, but we shouldn't elevate that to the level that, you know, that we're, you know, infallible, that we can't make mistakes, that the American way of life could crumble and fall around us. Because I think it's very plausible that, given the right horrible circumstances, I think it very much could. Yeah, that's pretty much my thoughts on it.
No, absolutely. I mean, look, the Soviet Union collapsed, and they're a very,
exactly,
very, very strong country.
Yeah.
You know, what makes us think that it can't happen to us, especially when we're trillions of dollars in debt? I mean,
exactly,
there's no way for us to pay that back. And
no.
I think they know that, and I think they're just spending us into collapse at this point. And I believe that they're trying to collapse us into the North American Union. You can tell by their actions and the laws and the acts that they're passing with NAFTA and the Trans-Pacific Partnership. They're trying to build super bloc countries, the European Union, the South American Union, the Asian Union, North American Union. And I think what we're seeing with Russia right now, like, everyone's like, oh, World War III is going to break out. This is worse than the Cuban Missile Crisis. You know what? Don't believe any of that stuff. I believe that all the leaders in the world right now, they're having secure video conferences with each other and planning this stuff out. Like, how can we bring in a new world order where we can start a new war, where we're not going to go nuclear, but we can take out a big portion of the population and just you know, steal more wealth? Because that's what's going on. We have an international criminal elite mafia that's controlling things. And, you know, sometimes the truth is really hard for people to grasp, because it's like a nightmare scenario that you would never want to believe. Like you said, America has that pride, and they just don't want to believe it. And I don't think it's the people, it's the leaders. The leaders have sold us out, and the people don't want to believe it. So they go along with the narrative. You know, they have their jobs to go to. They got to bring their kids to school. You know, what are they going to do, just drop everything and fight? You know, go to Washington, D.C. and, you know, say, you know, we want the president to resign. We want a whole new leadership. It's a lot more complicated than people think when they talk about it on the internet. Like, oh yeah, let's throw a revolution here too. It's not that easy.
And, no, I think a lot of it has to do with apathy and just complete laziness. That, you know, we are, you know, there's 300 plus million people in our country, and, you know, it would take something really catastrophic for people to set up a notice and do something. You know, and I think that, yeah, I think it comes down to, you know, I don't really care, you know, as long as I could take care of myself and my family, whatever, you guys do whatever you want, you know. I'll just sit on the sidelines and you know, I'm not going to do anything until you affect me, you know, on a deeply personal level, you know, like come into my house and take all my stuff from me or, you know, stuff like that. But I think that the things are being chipped away at that, it could easily downfall, you know, into that state where, you know, the American people would say, you know what, this is enough. But, you know, there's enough of us sitting around, looking around at everybody else saying, are you guys going to take this? You know, are you going to do something about it? And again, the laziness, you know, the apathy that, no, I'm good. I'm fine. You know, call me when things get worse. I think that's a lot of the problem right there.
Yeah, plus we have a real problem with leadership. No one wants to lead. They're always they don't want to take the risk. They always want someone else to step up. You know, like maybe when they see it on TV where we're already almost there and almost won the revolution, then they'll decide that they'll jump on board and help. Once they see that the threat is over and they're not going to go to jail or they're not going to thrown away under the Patriot Act forever. So your book starts out in the year 2027, right?
Yes.
That's, 13 years away?
Yeah, about 13 years, yeah.
So that's plausible with the things that are going on right now. That's actually a pretty good date, and your book is actually very possible. It talks about two major net combined disasters, some terrorist attacks that help accelerate the process.
Yes. Probably one of my favorite, you know, elements of the story is that the major world power, you know, 15 years from now, and this is fiction. I don't profess to be, you know, a prophet or anything, but the major world power is the great empire of Iran. In this storyline, Iran has conquered the Middle East, consolidated power, and when the book begins, the empire of Iran is slowly invading Europe. Well, Europe looks to the United States and says, hey, you know, remember that last world war? Maybe you can, you know, step over here and help us again. And the American people, the United States is just too broken, you know, to be able to help. And they kind of sit on the sidelines and, you know, kind of hope for the best that, you know, Europe will prevail. But one of my favorite elements in the book is that the Empire of Iran hasn't necessarily declared war on the United States. What they have done is they've sent probably a battalion-sized regiment of what I call the silent warriors. They sneak into the country. They have no real chain of command. Their only instructions are to wreak havoc, you know, panic and terror where they can. You know, it's not like Normandy where, you know, troops, you know, invade the beach and come up on the shore. That's not what we're dealing with here. They sneak into the country, you know, right under our noses, and they spread out. Yeah, exactly. They spread out across the country, and they commit, you know, acts of sabotage, you know, just things to terrify, you know, the nation. And one of my favorite, I hate to brag on myself, but one of my favorite lines in the book, fear is an intoxicating predator. That these terror attacks, they don't really combine us, you know, they don't really join us as a people. It makes us terrified of everybody, you know. Anybody that's walking down the street, you know, the guy sitting in the car next to you at the traffic light, your waiter at the restaurant, he might be one of them. You know, and that paranoia really grips, you know, the American public. And, you know, as a result, you know, lawlessness and crime just go through the roof, you know, because, you know, people are taking the law into their own hands, and it goes from there. But don't want to give away the ending of the book, but the nail in the coffin, it comes from the silent warriors, and they end up, you know, sending us back to the Stone Age, basically. And it's very exciting, but it, you know,